Tamara was gonna try to.
Good morning.
Morning.
Welcome. Happy Easter.
Happy Easter.
The candle that we just brought in is the candle that we put out on Good Friday, symbolizing Christ's death. And it is lit now on Easter morning, symbolizing the resurrection. So we just do that one day a year, and it's also lit for Christmas. So it just symbolizes just how special this morning is. And we just have a couple announcements, but first I just want to not only greet the folks that are here, but everyone who is online with us. We've had so many folks tuning in online, so we invite you to go ahead and type in your name if you want to, or greet your friends online. We're learning that we can be connected that way, even though we're distant socially. We are connected spiritually, and if you have a prayer request, you can type that in as well, and so many other things. And we're just delighted for everyone who is helping us celebrate Easter, who's helping with these worship services, and of course we're staying 6 feet apart, but and we want everyone to stay safe. Just a couple announcements this morning, the first being that next Sunday we will celebrate a special Emmaus Road home communion when we think about He walks with us. And so we invite you to get a bottle of grape juice or a bottle of wine, some bread, whatever you'd like. And next Sunday, we will celebrate communion together as folks celebrate at home, and we think about the story of the risen Lord on the road to Emmaus, and God's present with us now. There is a great tradition that I love in the Christian church as we turn to worship, which is on Easter especially. Someone says, Christ is risen, and everyone else says, He is risen indeed. And then I say, He is risen indeed, and you say, Christ is risen, so you can say it. You can also type it in wherever you are, and so, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He is risen indeed.
Christ is risen.
Happy Easter.
Happy Easter.
God bless you as we worship together wherever we are.
Two, three, four.
Good morning.
so we look at the words and come join us. Here we go.
I'm alive, I'm alive because He.
Thank you, music team. That was beautiful. We're so delighted that Tamra is here again to have another message for our children. So we invite you to get the children who are not there and to gather them around.
2, 3, and... church and my family, and I pray for everybody. The next one comes from Peyton Swift. Peyton says, pray that we can all get back to our church. I like that one. Anastasia Swift says, thank you, God, that you have made me. These are great prayers. The next one is from Kalia. Kalia says, dear God, please help our first responders and our medical staff heal all those who have the coronavirus. We know that you will get through this, and you will help us get through this. In Jesus' name we all pray. Amen. Michael says, God is great. God is good. Thank you, Jesus, for all your love. Noah Price. Noah Price prays that the people who have coronavirus will survive. And they need all of our prayers the most. And then our next prayer comes from Dominic. And Dominic says, I pray that the coronavirus will end soon and that everyone affected will be healed in God's name. Amen. And the next one comes from Fable May and Russell Budrow. We love you, Jesus. Thank you for dying on the cross for us. Amen. Thank you for, and today is a day where our prayers are truly lifting us up. And what I want you to do, because we've been talking about this for the past 6 Sundays and for 40 days during this Holy Week. So last Sunday, we had Palm Sunday, and you all waved your palm branches. And this week has been our Holy Week. And now this morning is the best day of the whole year, which is Easter. And what I want you to do is to get your sacred mat out. And remember the purple is the symbol of Lent. And the heart in the center is Jesus, Jesus' love. Well, this was representing our 6 weeks working up until Easter. So let's flip our mat over. Let's flip our sacred mat over. And let's put it on our cross side. So put your sacred mat in front of you right now. And then I also want you to grab your candle. And your sacred candle, and I want you to put that right there right now too. So I'm gonna set mine down right here. And then our scripture this morning, because I know a lot of you have been getting your Bible out during your sacred time with your sacred mat. And I've been getting awesome pictures of you. Some of you have even been watercoloring and painting your sacred mats throughout the week when you're doing your prayers. and putting stickers on them. I love it. So our Bible scripture verse this morning comes from the book of John, and it is chapter 3, verses 6. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever should believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Now remember, we have been showing Jesus' love, and during this time, we've been preparing for this very special day of Easter, and we covered our candle in black because this Holy Week has been the saddest week of the year. Now remember, Jesus died on the cross for us, and Jesus loved us to go to the cross for us and to die for us. God loved us enough that he rose Jesus from the dead just for us. And we know that Jesus is the light and the love and the joy, and that we get to live forever because of Jesus. So Easter is about love, profound love. For 6 weeks of Lent, we have shown this symbol, which is the heart. And this symbol is showing God's love. And I know a lot of you have been putting hearts out and putting them on your window and showing your love to all of the health workers in our area too. Jesus' love, though, was and always will be in us. But during this Holy Week, different people tried to kill the love of Jesus. And that was very sad, and a very sad week. So we fold up our heart showing that. But now we are showing and talking about the love of Jesus. And over the weeks, we have shown this love to get bigger. We showed each week as our heart and our love of Jesus grew to get bigger and bigger. And last week, our heart got even bigger for Jesus. Now, I'm going to show you a picture of, so all of you can see it too, that our love grew bigger as we saw that Jesus had died on the cross for us. He had also been raised from the dead. And that love will never be killed. And it can never leave us. And it will never leave us. It will always, always surround us forever and ever. Oh, hang on, I almost forgot. Okay. So this heart this morning, because it's Easter, shows us how much love we have for Jesus this morning. Look at how much love we have for him. This huge heart is how much love we have for Jesus. If you can, or if you add something big enough today, whether I just took a tablecloth that Terry helped me find at church, and this big heart was made. So if you have an old tablecloth or something, make sure you get Mom and Dad's permission. You can make your huge heart of love for Jesus today to show that joy for Easter and that Jesus is always, always love, no matter what happens to us in life, no matter what we may be going through today. Jesus is love, and it's huge, just like this heart, and it's pure love. Now grab your sacred candle. Now, we know that this week that those tried to actually put out the light of Jesus. But that's all done now because it is Easter. So we're going to get rid of our black paper that was sad. And we're going to get rid of our purple paper too because we're done with Lent. And remember, this purple paper was the sign of showing Jesus is our King. And we get back to our white candle, showing purity and pure perfection. And that Jesus, let's turn our light on, is the light of the world. Not even death could destroy Jesus' light. And that is what Easter is all about. And we all want to make sure that as we are thinking about Easter today, no matter where you go, no matter what you do, whether you are staying in your home or in your backyard, the light of Jesus will always shine. You can't put it out. You can't be rid of his light. Jesus will forever and ever be your King in your heart. He is your light and your Savior, and he loves you, just like that huge heart that I just showed you. Happy Easter to all of you, and make this day special for your whole family. Continue to go back to your sacred mat today, and be still, and know God, and sit there with your sacred candle, and be still and think about the amazing thing that Jesus rose from the dead. Let us all pray. Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross for all of us. We love you so much, and we love your light, and help us to shine your light bright every day. Happy Easter, Jesus. Amen.
Tamara and Jay and our music team and everyone who's helping to put this service together, and everyone online, thank you for being with us today. This morning we continue our series Following Jesus, and this morning we're looking at one more move, and we are in Luke's gospel. And it reminds me that Luke was a doctor, that he was one of those serving in the medical profession. And as you look at these beautiful flowers here this morning, it's an Easter tradition that we decorate the cross with flowers. We put all these flowers out here, and then the families who have paid for those and put them in honor of different folks have those listed, and they take those home. This morning, we decided to do something different, which is many of the folks who ordered these flowers, instead of taking them home, are going to dedicate those and take them over to the hospitals later today. So those will be going to the hospital. A number of them will be. Others will be out where folks can pick them up in front of the church. But many of these will be going to those in our medical profession. They'll be taken to the hospital so that they know that they're in our thoughts and prayers, that we really appreciate what they're doing on the front line. And so this morning we look at Dr. Luke's gospel and think about one more move, and we are in Luke chapter 24, verses 1 through 12, and it is the story of the first Easter Sunday. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like light. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee, the Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again." Then they remembered his words. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and all the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, James, and the others with them who told this to the apostles, because their words seemed so full of nonsense. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb. Bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and he went away, wondering to himself what had happened. May the Lord bless his word to our hearts and minds this morning. Well, as I said, this morning we're looking at one more move, and some of the folks have said, please, in this time of COVID-19, continue the humor. We need a little humor to get through all this, and so I have heard their wishes, and I want to start this morning with a true story that I've heard that I love, and the story goes that there was this pastor one time who had this very unusual job, and his job was to do the funerals for all the churches out in the rural areas that were too small to have a pastor of their own. So he got to know a number of the funeral directors quite well, and he would drive with them to these faraway, distant rural areas. And on one particular trip, he was driving back with a funeral director in a hearse, and it was a rather long drive, and he turned to the funeral director and said, "Listen, you know, I'm really tired. Do you mind if I just sort of lay down in the back of the hearse and take a nap?" And the funeral director said, "Sure, no problem." And so he laid down and went to sleep, and pretty soon the funeral director realized that he was getting low on gas, and so he pulled into a gas station and asked the attendant if he would fill up the hearse with gas. And meanwhile, the funeral attendant went inside to pay for the gas, and the funeral attendant was filling the hearse up with gas, and he turned and he looked in the back of the hearse, and he saw this body lying there with no casket or anything, and he was pretty freaked out by that. And so he turned back to the gas pump and was just minding his own business, filling the hearse up with gas, and just then the pastor woke up and from his nap, and he wondered exactly where he was, and so he bangs on the window of the hearse, and the gas station attendant slowly turns, and the pastor yells through the glass, "Can you tell me where I am?" Well, you never saw anyone run so fast in our life. Well, you know, for all of us, many times we are uncomfortable with death. We just don't know quite what to do. And of course, in the midst of this COVID-19 thing, many of us have kind of looked at this, and so I think the Easter story, at no other time, perhaps, has had as much meaning to so many different people. And so I invite you to walk back with me into this story. And we think about this in the first Easter. We think about the disciples who, that first morning, were huddled behind doors. And the women were the ones who went to the tomb that first Easter. They had more courage than the men who were hiding in fear, and so they went to the tomb, and you had to wonder what was going through their minds. And I think it reminds me that we all have just several options that we can do when we're confronted by death. And the first one is to just deny it. We see many people who live in sort of a denial of death. We go about our business too afraid to even confront it. It's too hard of a topic. And we do that perhaps by the way we live our lives, maybe sometimes recklessly, or just maybe even just kind of with our eyes closed, the whole possibility. And we think there were folks at that time too who were simply denying the reality. It was just too much for them. And then there's other folks who just live in fear and anxiety of death. And I think we're all tempted to do that at times when we're confronted with death. The disciples were afraid. They were behind closed doors. The women had some courage and were going to the tomb, but were told that they were full of fear and trembling and just greatly troubled. And so all of us are touched in moments like that, and we wonder, what are we going to do in moments like that when we're confronted by this? But you know, there's a third option. I think that's the option that Mary chose when she looked into the empty tomb. And what is that third option? That third option is to be filled with hope, because Easter changes everything. I know those women and certain disciples didn't realize that when they went to the tomb that day, that the stone would be rolled away and the tomb would be empty. And we think today about some of the places that are empty in our own world today, and we think about places that are normally full, right? We think of baseball stadiums and football stadiums. We think of schools, and we think even of churches that are normally full during the weekend. They're empty, and in some sense, that's a sign of isolation and fear and anxiety. But on that first Easter, when the tomb was empty, it was a sign of hope. And I think that hope changes everything. And I think in our own ways, we face the reality of empty buildings today. We realize that there's a sign of hope and all that. And that hope changes everything. As Mary looked into the tomb and saw those two angels with glistening clothes of white speak words of hope, "He's not here, he is risen," everything changed. She ran back to the disciples and carried the news to them, and they did not believe it at first, but then there was a glimmer in Peter's heart and in John's heart, and they began to walk, I suppose, and then run to the tomb, and then they too looked into the empty tomb and found that everything had changed because the empty tomb brought hope. And in our own lives, so many times we find that the hope of the resurrection changes everything, doesn't it? We think of Paul who says, we grieve, but we do not grieve as those who have no hope. Because even when we confront death, we realize that we now have the hope of the resurrection. That first Easter changed everything. We're filled with new possibilities in the face of sometimes things that would normally destroy our lives and make us live in denial or hope or fear and anxiety. I love the story of Julie Andrews. You may remember her from Mary Poppins and The Sound of Music. And she was a very successful actress and singer, of course. And then there was a point in her life when she went to the doctor and she had some nodules on her vocal cords. And so she was very nervous about the surgery, and she went into surgery and came out, and it was a bad outcome. And she found out that she could speak, but she could not sing any longer. And she was devastated by that because everything that she had lived for, her songs, her music meant everything to her. And she was talking to her daughter about it one day, and her daughter said, you know, you're going to have to learn to sing with a new voice. And so she began to think about new possibilities in her life. And she took up a career as a writer of children's stories. And now has written a number of children's stories. Some of them have been made into films and others into plays. And she was reflecting on that when she was 83 years old and the success she'd known as a writer of children's stories. And she said, you know, I never would have discovered that new voice had not I lost my voice. And she said, you know, when God closes a door, he always opens a window. I think that's true when we look at the tomb where the stone was rolled away, the tomb that was empty, and we realize that God always gives us hope in the midst of a crisis because of that Easter morning. It gives us hope when we face adversity and difficulty and challenges each and every day, and it touches our lives in ways that it never would otherwise. In my own life, some 6 years ago, I remember I received a call from my sister, and it was a desperate call, and I returned it immediately, and she told me that her husband, Ray, had a massive heart attack, and it did not look good, and she was following the ambulance, she had done CPR, and we said a prayer, but it just seemed so difficult, and even then, I was getting ready with my daughter to travel to Virginia, where she was at the time, and I recall the news that things did not turn out the way that we wanted. The miracle that we had prayed for, the way we had prayed for that miracle was not turning out the way that we wanted. And I remember looking online for a moment on Facebook, and I had notifications that sort of flashed up on my phone. And his son, my nephew, Raymond, had the same name, and he was getting on a plane, and he had put a picture of his father on his Facebook post, and he said, on my way home. And I remember seeing the picture of my brother-in-law come up on my phone and said, on my way home. And I just went like it was from him, on my way home. And I realized that was a note of comfort amidst deep grief and difficulty. Later, when we got to Virginia, my daughter and I went to the store to buy a card for my sister and my daughter's Aunt Susie. And so we were in the store, we were getting a card, and I said, well, listen, why don't you help me get a card? And my daughter said, well, no, Dad, I want to get my own card for Aunt Susie and the family. And I said, well, okay, go ahead and get your own card. And so she picked out a really nice card, and you know, I had my card there. And then I said, well, let me help you write something to Aunt Susie. And she said, Dad, I don't want you to write something to Aunt Susie. I want to write something on my own. I thought, well, I wonder what she's going to write. And so she sat down, and she wrote. And what she wrote was this. She said, Dear Aunt Susie, we are so sorry about Uncle Ray. We loved him, but we know that he is with God and God is with us. And I thought to myself, wow. From this girl who was just 10 years old at the time came those words of hope that I think transformed the moment the grief and the difficulty did not go away, but in that moment we felt some strength and we knew some hope that brought a new light into a darkened day. I think give us hope in the face of death and the possibility of death all around us today and whenever we have faced it in our life, but I think it also gives us strength day to day. I remember when I was getting a group of college students ready to go to a mission trip sometime just after Hurricane Katrina had devastated New Orleans, and our prayers go with the folks in New Orleans right now who are wrestling with this present pandemic, as well as those in New York City and across our country. But I recall an interview on one of the morning news shows, a couple of women who were FEMA workers, and they had volunteered and they'd worked 36 hours straight. And so the reporter was interviewing these women and asked them, how in the world did you just keep going in the midst of this crisis for 36 hours? And this woman said, listen, I have one of these yellow Lance Armstrong Be Strong wristbands. Remember when those were popular and it said Be Strong? And she said, I just look down and I'm feeling tired at that wristband that says Be Strong. And I think of Lance Armstrong coming through the Alpine Mountains in Europe and the strength that he had. And that gives me strength in a difficult time. And that sounded really good. And so the reporter turned to the other woman who was a volunteer for FEMA. And he said, well, listen, how do you cope with 36 hours straight? And the woman said, well, you know what? I serve a God who created all those mountains. And when I'm feeling weak and when I need strength, I just lean into the one who can move those Alpine Mountains. And I think that's really true, even truer than the first statement. And you and I today face difficulties, and sometimes it saps our strength, and sometimes it drains our hope, but we follow a God that not only made the mountains and can move the mountains, but was incredible enough to move the stone in front of the tomb that first Easter morning. So whatever we're struggling with today, whether it's the loss of a loved one from this pandemic or something else, and we wrestle and want hope, and we are in fear and anxiety and feeling lonely and isolated, we can think of those women who went to that empty tomb and realized that sometimes emptiness is a sign of hope, because we know that He is not here, He is risen. And because He's risen, He is with us now. God always has one more move. It was a move that was not expected by the women that went there. It was a move that was not expected by the disciples. It was a move that no one expected at all. But we serve and we follow on God that is capable of one more move when we think all is lost and all is desperate. I want to close with a true story that I love. And the story is told of this man who was a friend of the great chess champion, Paul Morphy. And they went to the Louvre Museum in Paris, and they were walking through the museum, and this friend of Paul Morphy said, listen, I want to show you this painting that I love. And so they walked over to this painting, and he said, this is checkmate. And it was this picture of this figure of a young man who was playing chess, with a figure symbolizing Satan or death, however you interpret that. And it was checkmate, meaning that the young man didn't have any more moves. And the young man was lost because he had no hope and was ready to give up. And the great chess champion Morphy studied that painting and he said, you know what? I don't think that's right. And he said, I would like you to go get a chessboard. And so he put the chessboard down next to the painting, and of course, he as a chess champion knew more than the painter about that, and so he set them up and he said, you go ahead and you be death, and I'll be this young man. And he said, I want to show you something. He said, the king has one more move. And with that, he moved the king, and it wasn't checkmate. It changed everything. It changed the outcome. And I think that's a great illustration for us this morning, because when you thought that death had checkmated all of life, and we think that hope is lost, and you think that there's not one more move, Jesus came and had one more move that first Easter morning, and the stone was rolled away, and new hope came into a darkened world. That's the God who has one more hope, one more step, one more move in all of our lives. And so wherever we are today, when we think that all hope is lost and that things couldn't get any worse and things are darkened and our life are overcome with fear and anxiety and without hope, realized that that first Easter morning, God had one more move, and it was to roll aside the tomb and to bring life where there was death, to bring light where there was darkness, to bring hope where there was nothing but anxiety and fear, and to bring love in an empty world. And so today, we serve a Lord who is risen, who always has one more move, who can give us the power to overcome death itself, because Christ had one more move that Easter and this Easter as well. Would you join me in prayer? Lord, as we think about that first Easter morning, sometimes we forget that the morning began in the hearts of these women and disciples as a day that seemed without hope, a day that was full of denial even, and fear and anxiety and sadness and grief. But all that changed when they found out that you had one more move, the move to roll aside the stone from the tomb and to discover an empty tomb, that our hearts and lives will be full of hope and love and joy and grace this morning. So help us to open our hearts and lives to the good news of the resurrection this day, to realize that whatever situation seems too dark, that you bring light into it. Whatever situation seems too sad and lonely and isolated, that you bring hope and peace and love and joy. We're thankful for that first Easter, and we're thankful for this Easter, for we are a people who live with a risen Lord who is with us now and who will be with us through all of life, even the greatest challenge and adversity. And all God's people said,
the round began to shake.
Beautiful, thank you. We invite folks, wherever you are, to join with us in prayer this morning. Lord, we thank you for this Easter morning when people from all races and places all around our world are celebrating the resurrection. They're celebrating hope and life. And even as our hearts and lives are weighed down this morning by some of the burdens and cares that we have and some of the grief that we carry for those around our world, we want to pause for a moment and just give you thanks for the blessings of life and love that you give us. We're so thankful as we look around us today to see that spring and the promise of new life is blooming all around us. As we look at these flowers this morning, we are thankful for every season of life and every season of the year, for there's blessings in each and every one of them. Lord, we're thankful even in the midst of this pandemic that sometimes we've been able to slow down and to reconnect with family and friends and to find new miracles and all of that. We're thankful that we look around and see the heroism of those who are serving others far and wide, and we're thankful that you still are Lord of all. Lord, we also lift up all the needs that are with us this morning. We think of those who've lost loved ones and pray that your peace would be with those in a very special way, and your strength and love today and in days and weeks ahead. We think also of those who are sick even right now, whether at home or nursing home or in hospitals near and far. We pray, Lord, that you continue to lead and guide and bless the doctors and nurses and medical staff that are caring for them. Give them wisdom and guidance and strength, we pray. But we also pray that you, our great physician, would touch and strengthen them in body, mind, and spirit. We pray for each person who's troubled and anxious this morning, Lord, that they would feel your hope and peace in a special way. We pray for all of us as we have some of this time to quiet ourselves and to be at home. You give us a new hope in our life to reconnect with some of those who feel isolated, or reconnect in a greater way even with those in our own families. But most of all, Lord, help us to reconnect with you. We pray as our lives slow down in many respects that we will look up to you and realize the great gift of love that you offered as Jesus Christ come among us to share our lives and to give his life and the greatest gift of love of all time on the cross, that we would know your forgiveness and grace and love in the greatest way possible, and then was raised to new life that first Easter morning, that we would have the promise of new life in this life and the life to come. Help us to open our hearts and lives to your forgiveness and grace and love today and each and every day. We pray that we live life with a new vitality, with new hope to be shared with others, and that we would learn to love and serve you greater and to love and serve you others through loving and serving you. We pray this in the name of Christ Jesus, our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever.
Oh,
you. Speaking of thanking the Lord, we have some prayers that folks have sent in to us, and we want to share those with you now. And we invite you, wherever you are, to lift up your prayers as well as these. And the first one is from Jim and Benita Hazelwood, and we missed their Good Friday prayer, so we're going to have both their Good Friday and Easter prayer, and they write this. My soul weeps as I walk with you to the cross, but rejoices in knowing of the life to come. Amen. Hallelujah. You have arose and my sins are forgiven. I can now say all is well with my soul. Amen and amen.
This prayer is from Little Cooper Hall, which is Don and Janice Partlow's grandson. And Cooper says, praise that spring is here and that I can be outside again. And also from their little baby grandson, Carson Hall, praise for the newfound skill of climbing. The next one comes from Holly Collins and Jill Collins. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this Easter Sunday, this day that when you rose from the dead and you conquered any battle anyone would ever face. We thank you always for walking with us. We know as we deal with this and every battle on earth that you are with us. Through you, we will get through this too. Amen. The next one is from Terry. And Terry's prayer this morning is right here.
I pray that on Easter morning, people from all over the world come to know you as their Lord and Savior. And those who know and love you will grow in their relationship with you. Thank you for your love and grace and the gift of eternal life. Amen.
And the next prayer comes from Brenda O'Brien. Dear Lord, thank you for our lives and for the forgiveness of your promise of us through the sacrifice of your Son. Give us all strength and patience. Use our time wisely now and love so deeply. In your name we pray. Amen. And this comes from Dennis O'Brien.
Heavenly Father, trust in us to do your work through Jesus Christ. Teach us patience and love during this Easter season. Although the church may be empty, rejoice in the tomb being empty as well. Amen.
And I just want to say happy anniversary to them today, too. It's a joyous day. This is from Kenzie Kretzmeyer and from Ross House together. Dear Lord, thank you for rising from the dead for our sins. We love you deeply. Amen. And this prayer comes from Jay and I. Dear Lord, thank you for the joy in Easter today. We are grateful for Pastor TJ and his strength and his messages that he is sharing with all of us. We are so very grateful for Terry Seeger and for her granddaughter, Kalia, for spending 3 hours yesterday outside waving at all of the people in Lafayette that drove by in the Easter Bunny suit. God bless them. We're also grateful for the music team to share their talents with us every morning, and for Don Partlow, for all of you to hear the message this morning, and for Paul House, for you to be able to see the message this morning. Lord, we are grateful for all the virtual churches being able to reach out to millions and to share your word and to make more of your children this morning on your blessed Easter. Amen. This next one comes from Janice and Don Partlow.
We praise God for the ability and opportunity to spend time with our grandsons Cooper and Carson during this time of isolation. Cooper Hall praises that spring is here and we can be outside. I think all of us can say amen to that. And Carson prays for the newfound skill of climbing.
And our last prayer this morning comes from Marcy and Steve Ritchie.
Christ the Lord is risen today. Alleluia. Amen. We can all say that. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
He is risen. Christ is risen. We know that all the folks tuning in have lots of prayers, and so we unite together in prayer at a very special time. And our thanks to everyone for tuning in.
Let's try together and sing "Give Thanks."
1, 2, 3.
Go forth with the blessing of Almighty God, the love of the Father, the grace of our Lord and Savior, Christ Jesus, and the peace and power of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. God bless you, and have a happy Easter.
1, 2, 3. Amen.